I get a call 2:30 in the morning. I'm half awake, you know, I've got a TV guide on my chest, and I hear this voice say, "Can you be at the Spruce and Elm Country Golf Club for 9 a.m. tomorrow morning?" I immediately know who this is. Nicholson, Jack's partner in this celebrity golf tournament, pulled out last minute, classic Warren Beatty. He's telling me it's for a good cause. You know, it's a bring back the blue whales benefit, which I had no idea we were running low on. 2 holes into the next morning, and already Nicholson is telling me about 3 pretty ladies he just met on the golf course and how he was... Insert several Nicholson complicated sexual innuendos here. All of a sudden, my good friend Don Woolworth pulls up in a golf cart, all in a panic, telling me I gotta fill in for this director that just got fired off the set of a Sunny D commercial. I immediately say yes, because I hear Sunny D is paying the big bucks those days. Sunny D, you know, so Jack says, "Are you kidding me?" And I'm like, "Are you kidding me? I'm not getting bread for this. You're just here for the girls. And how do we even know if the blue whales are even gone? Is there a guy that goes out in the middle of the ocean, dives down, he looks around, I can't see them. I guess they're gone. Does he know how many miles deep the ocean is? It's gotta be a couple hundred." So it's mid-morning, I arrive on set in my golf attire, and already the atmosphere is tense and stuffy. Partly because the windows were all closed and it was a hot day. So the clients are having this very heated conversation about whether or not they can use Katrina and the Waves Walking on Sunshine, which seemed slightly appropriate. I suggest that since we're on the topic of top 40s, that they consider my good old pal John Bond and his beautiful hit, "Living on a Prayer." But they're not having it, so I'm like, that's their loss, you know. If you don't like John Bond, you shouldn't be in the business. They don't get the okay from Katrina. And I say, you know what, let's scrap all this top 40 jazz. You really want to get the viewers' attention, play some very ominous instrumental music. It's not quite right in the stomach. You know, you don't know what's going to happen. Is the mother going to open the cupboard door too quick, get smacked the side of her head and go straight into a coma? The kid's going to jaywalk and suddenly get hit by a bus? Nobody knows. You're lured in by this very creepy, eerie music.
I got it! I'm not sure.
2 hours into shooting, I keep staring at this woman that I'm directing, Debbie Price, who's playing the mother. Suddenly it hits me. I've had relations with this woman. Sexual relations. She, of course, recognized me right off the bat. I just, you know, it had been a few years, and she had her hair up, which she normally would have down. She looked like a completely different person. To make it even more awkward, she was one of the reasons, if not the reason, for my first divorce. So there was a bit of overlapping between my ex-wife and her. But now it's too late to say anything, so I just keep pretending like I don't know her. She's giving me scary stink eye, and I start sweating like Kenny G opening for a Guns N' Roses concert.
You in the jungle, baby! You gonna die!
We get to the scene that wasn't working with the previous director when I got fired. He was giving the boys a simple direction of go to the fridge, open the fridge, take the Sunny D out, close the fridge, and drink. Your boring mom called and wants her boring director son back. I mean, Jesus. So I come in with my director big guns and I say, here's what I want. OJ, cola, and other miscellaneous liquids all in the fridge. I tell the lead kid, Guy Phillips, to list off all the beverages and then land on Sunny D. We do a couple beautiful takes, but the clients are like, something's missing. And I get my props guy, Freddie Herman, to go get me a juice container filled up with something purple. He comes back with the container full of red wine and says, here's the purple stuff. The clouds open up. God says, hey, I exist for a few minutes. And you're like, I think you do, because this idea is genius. We do another take, and I tell Guy to refer to the container as purple stuff. And he says, wow, great name. And I says, yeah, I know, I just thought of it. I just came in my head. We do the take and the clients love it. Their minds are blown. Like I just, you know, recited some Shakespeare or something.
Hey, we got some soda. OJ, purple stuff, sunglasses.
You know, but something's still not right with me. I asked Freddie to make the wine a little bit lighter because it's kind of looking like wine to me. Maybe just because I was thinking about wine. He comes back with a beautiful sparkling purple, compliments of antifreeze from his car. We do the final take, it's priceless. Everyone's happy, and we break for lunch. An hour later, we're back on set. Freddie comes up to me and says, the purple stuff has disappeared. I'm like, what are you talking about? So we start looking around. We head outside and find that the boys have not only drank all the purple stuff, but are now violently vomiting all over the backyard. A guy overheard purple stuff had wine in it. He just didn't hear that it also had antifreeze. It was like the lard-ass scene in Stand By Me. You know, just a mess. Purple stuff just flying everywhere. The clients are freaking out and insisting that we take these boys to the hospital, but I'm like, if we don't finish the shoot, I'm not gonna get paid. The boys are insistent that we finish the shoot, partly because they're drunk or high from the fumes of the antifreeze and they don't know any better. So I'm like, we'll quickly shoot the last couple scenes and we'll call an ambulance if we need to call an ambulance. As luck would have it, the last few scenes were horrendous. They were just getting really rowdy and punching, physical with each other, to the point where I had to decide from one crappy take to the other. So finally, I call it. I've got to now deal with this footage of teenage drunks. Reluctantly call the ambulance. Just when I thought this day couldn't get any crazier, Debbie walks up to me, and I'm thinking, uh-oh, here it comes. She says to me, listen, Mr. Playing Hard to Get. This is my Debbie, by the way. I was mad at you earlier, but I was so impressed with your directorial contribution to the purple stuff that I almost forgot how much a creative genius you are. And I'm like, what day is this? Christmas Day? This is happening. Debbie Price. So we immediately started dating after that for a couple months. I had to break it off eventually because, you know, this new hair updo, it just wasn't working for me. She looked so different. I was like, this isn't Debbie. I used to say, where's Debbie? And she'd say, I'm right here. And I'm like, no, you're not. No, you're not. Not that I know of.